Hi everyone, this is Dr. Bhaumik Joshi from Aspire MDS. Welcome to this video lecture on pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetics is a description of time course of drug in the body that includes ADME, that is absorption, distribution, metabolism and excretion. In simpler words, you can call it as what the body does to the drug. So pharmacokinetics, as I told, includes absorption, distribution, metabolism and excretion. When the drug is absorbed in its original form, it is released from its tablet or whatever form it is in the form of a solution. Now this solution gets distributed. Its distribution is to the site of action and to the places where it gets stored. In both of these places, it can be either in a bound form or a free form. The free form from both of the site of action and storage form will go to blood. In the blood, this free drug can have different fates. One, it can either get bound to the protein, that is plasma protein bound form of the drug, or it can be free. The free drug gets biotransformed into different parts. For example, if the drug was in the form of prodrug, it will get activated and become the active molecule. Or the drug can get metabolized and it can get excreted in the form of urine, bile, feces, sweat and saliva. So drug absorption can be in the form of simple or passive diffusion, active transport, facilitated or carrier mediated diffusion or pinocytosis. To understand the structure of cell membrane, the cell membrane consisted of bilayer of phospholipid and cholesterol molecules. The polar parts or the hydrophilic parts of these groups are oriented at the two surfaces, and the non-polar hydrocarbon chains are embedded in the matrix to form the continuous sheet. This characteristic imparts high electrical resistance and impermeability to this membrane. As we can see, the hydrophilic and water-loving part are on the outside and the inner side hydrocarbon part are hydrophobic parts. This membrane also has extrinsic and intrinsic protein molecules that are absorbed in the lipid layers. Some of the intrinsic ones, which extend through and through the cell membrane, they consist of the aqueous pore. Now talking about simple diffusion is nothing but diffusion along the concentration gradient. Now here you can see the red and blue drug molecules. The red molecules are lipid soluble drugs and the blue molecules are lipid or non-lipid soluble or water soluble drugs. The lipid soluble drugs can easily pass through the membrane because they can get diffused in the lipid. But the water soluble drugs, they need aqueous pore in order to pass through this membrane. So the water soluble drugs that are the part of drug that is ionized or polar, it is readily absorbed via aqueous membrane. Whereas lipid soluble drug that is non-ionized part can get readily absorbed via cell membrane itself. The characteristic of simple diffusion are: one, that it is a non-selective. Second, it requires no energy. It does not require any carrier. It depends on lipid solubility and it depends on pKa of drug or pH of the medium. Now let's understand this. The weakly acidic drugs which form salts with cation, example sodium phenobarbital, sodium sulfur diazine, potassium penicillin V, they ionize more at alkaline pH. That is, weakly acidic drug will be ionized more at the alkaline pH. Now we should understand that this ionized part are the ones that are water soluble and cannot easily pass through the cell membrane. So the weakly acidic drug will become lesser effective in the alkaline pH. So one scale change in the pH will cause tenfold change in the ionization. So even smaller change in pH, it will cause more ionization and more difference will be there. The weakly basic drugs, they form salt with anions. The examples are atropine sulfate, ephedrine hydrochloride, chloroquine phosphate, etc. They ionize more at the acidic pH. So the lipid insoluble ions, they do not diffuse through the cell membrane. So the pH difference will be there across the membrane and it can cause differential distribution of either weakly acidic or weakly basic drugs.
In this example, we can see this compartment where pH is 5, that means it is acidic. Here, the pH is 7, that means this is a neutral or comparatively basic compartment. Now here, for a weakly acidic drug will become ionized in the basic compartment, where like you can see that 100 ionized form are there as compared to 10 unionized form. Whereas in acidic medium, only one ionized form is there as compared to 10 unionized form. Now we know that unionized or lipid soluble molecules of drug only can cross the membrane. So when a compartment like these are present, when a compartment like these two are present, there will be a differential distribution of drug as we saw in this example. The acidic drugs, they can cross the membrane in the acidic medium only, because acidic drugs are lipid soluble in acidic medium. So the acidic drug must be in unionized form in order to cross the membrane. As the gastric pH is acidic, the acidic drugs are more likely to be absorbed from the stomach, because this will be unionized form here. Aspirin is more likely to be absorbed in the stomach as compared to morphine or atropine, because aspirin is weak acid. They are best absorbed in the stomach. Morphine and atropine are weak bases and they are best absorbed in the intestine. The next form of transfusion is carrier-mediated or facilitated diffusion. It occurs along the concentration gradient. It requires carriers. It is selective and there is no use of energy. As we can see here, in the passive diffusion over here, the concentration is more on this side as compared to this side. So easily they are passed, the lipid soluble molecules are passing through the membrane to the area where lesser concentration is present. Here also the molecules are passing from more concentration to lesser concentration, but here this carrier molecule is present, that is facilitating the transport. So this form of diffusion is facilitated diffusion and this is simple passive diffusion. Both of them are types of passive diffusion only. The next kind of transport is active transport. Active transport means this kind of transport requires use of energy. Because it is occurring against the concentration gradient. It is, and even this transport is specific for certain molecules. The example of active transport includes iron absorption and uptake of levodopa by brain. In this example, we can see that this drug molecules are passing from lower concentration towards higher concentration as opposed to the passive diffusion we saw. For that, here also this carrier molecule or gateway is present and there is use of energy as we saw in this image. Now this active transport can be in the form of unipod, simpod or antipod. Unipod is just now what we saw, one molecule is passing from lower concentration to higher concentration along the carrier.
Simpod is where a carrier, as we see in this image, a substrate A, it moves against the concentration gradient by utilizing the energy from the downhill movement of another object that is moving in the same direction through the same carrier. Whereas antipod is when carrier moves, like for example a substrate moves from one side to other sides against the concentration gradient, and for this it gets energy from another molecule that is moving through the same carrier but in the opposite direction. Difference between passive transport and active transport. Passive transport is along the concentration gradient, whereas active transport is against the concentration gradient. There is no carrier in the passive transport, whereas there is need for the carrier in the active transport. The passive transport is non-selective and non-saturable as compared to active transport, and there is no requirement for energy in passive transport. Difference between active transport and facilitated diffusion. Both of them require carriers, but in active transport there is requirement of energy because it is against the concentration gradient, whereas in the carrier mediated diffusion there is no requirement of energy because it is along the concentration gradient. This can help you easily remember difference between passive, facilitated and active diffusion. Both passive
and facilitated diffusion are both passive and facilitated diffusion are towards the concentration gradient. So they do not require any energy. Just that in facilitated diffusion, it has a carrier to facilitate the diffusion. Whereas active transport is happening against the concentration gradient, and for that it requires energy. Another mode is phagocytosis. The one is endocytosis, where uptake of molecules from outside, it is through the membrane bound particles. Whereas exocytosis is where expulsion of membrane bound particles occurs in the periphery. The drugs which are high molecular weight or highly lipid insoluble, they gets endocytosized or exocytosized through this mechanism. Next point is bioavailability. Bioavailability is the rate and extent of absorption of a drug from a dosage form as determined by its concentration time curve in blood or by its excretion in the urine. It is a measure of fraction of administered dose of drug that reaches the systemic circulation in the unchanged form. Bioavailability of drug injected IV is 100% theoretically, but when it is given orally, it does not give 100% digestion. There are two reasons. One, that a drug may not get completely absorbed, and second is even from the absorbed drug, many of it undergoes first pass metabolism in the intestinal wall or liver to be excreted in the bile. Another modes of drug delivery like subcutaneous or intramuscular injection, only very less commonly you will see incomplete bioavailability, but it can occur due to local binding of these drugs. Now a term to understand is area under the curve. Area under the curve is when you see this curve A, the area that it covers is area under curve of A, and same way area under curve B will be the area that I am highlighting right now. So here you can see the formulation B is more slowly absorbed than A. The x-axis over here is time. So the time taken for full absorption by B is more than A. So that's what it is saying. The formulation B is more slowly absorbed than A, and though ultimately both are absorbed in the same extent, the area under curve shows the extent to which they are absorbed. B may not produce therapeutic effect. The dotted line over here we see is the therapeutic concentration. It is the concentration that requires to be attained in the body in order to produce the therapy or to produce the therapeutic effect. So B may not produce the therapeutic effect. C over here, again, it does not produce therapeutic concentration, but it is absorbed to a lesser extent, so it also has a lower bioavailability as compared to B. To understand this curve in context of bioavailability, bioavailability can be calculated by comparing area under curve for IV route and for that particular route. For example, if you want to calculate bioavailability for the oral route, in that case we have to calculate by this formula, that is area under curve for oral route of delivery and area under curve for IV drug of delivery. It can also be calculated same way for excretion in the urine. So area under the curve, what does it tell to us? It tells about the extent of absorption of that drug. Here we can see T max. It tells us about the time to reach the maximum concentration, that is rate of absorption, and Cmax is the maximum concentration of drug that can be obtained. This we just now discussed. There are different factors that affect the bioavailability. They include molecular weight of drug, drug formulation. Now this is important to understand that which form of drug is more easily or more bioavailable. So solution is having most bioavailability as compared to suspension, capsule or tablet. So between tablet and capsule is having more bioavailability. Solubility of drug, chemical instability in the gastric pH and first plus metabolism are some of the factors that are affecting the bioavailability. Another term is bioequivalence. The oral formulation of a drug from different companies or even in the or even in the same company, if same drug is formed in two different batches, they can have different amount of blood level that is obtained. So this kind of drugs are called biologically inequivalent. Two preparation of drug are considered bioequivalent when the rate and extent of bioavailability of active drug from them is not significantly different under the suitable test conditions. Next point is drug distribution. So once the drug is in the bloodstream, it gets distributed throughout the body. Only a little amount of drug will be in contact with the actual receptors at any given time. Most of the other drug is in the area remote from the site of action, like plasma binding sites, muscle tissue, adipose tissue, liver, or kidney. Factors that affect the absorption, they also affect the storage or accumulation of this drug in the tissue. Drug will accumulate greatly in adipose or fat tissue, that is 18 to 28% of body. Usually they are not active in the fat. Only the cases where they become active in the fat is when a person starts losing fat, for example during dieting or starving, and they'll slowly re-enter the bloodstream. Concept of redistribution is well explained by thiopental. So this thiopental is an anesthetic and very lipid soluble drug. It enters the brain as soon as it is injected, that is, it enters very quickly, and it follows the concentration gradient out of the brain back into the circulation, that is, it gets redistributed from the brain to the circulation. So it enters the fat tissue and it gets stored there. Therefore the effect is short, because once it is in the brain it starts getting distributed, but because it slowly comes out of the brain, the effect may linger for many hours. The drug distribution also is different between male and female, because women have lesser water and more fat. So the drug action differs in both of them in some manner. Volume of distribution. The apparent volume of distribution, presuming that the body behaves as a single unit, the volume into which the drug gets immediately and uniformly distributed is called as volume of distribution. The formula for this is dose administered IV divided by plasma concentration. For example, the dose administered IV here is 100 mg and the plasma concentration of this drug is 50 mg per liter. So for this case, the volume of distribution will be 20 liter. This thing we need to remember, that certain drugs can cross the blood-brain barrier and certain drugs cannot. So only the drugs that are lipid soluble can cross the blood-brain barrier, because the brain capillaries, they are having this glial cells or choroidal epithelium surrounding them. So only the drugs that are non-polar or lipid soluble can easily cross through this membrane, whereas the other lipid insoluble drugs that can easily pass through the other capillaries, they cannot pass through the blood-brain barrier. The next concept is plasma protein binding. So highly plasma protein bound drugs, they are largely restricted to the vascular compartment. They are the bound fraction and they are not available for the action. High degree of protein binding generally makes the drug longer acting, because bound fraction is not available for metabolism or excretion and they can be used once they are out from the bond. Generally expressed plasma concentration of the drug refers to bound as well as free drugs. One drug can bind to many sites on the albumin molecule. Conversely, more than one drug can bind to the same site. This can give rise to displacement interaction among drugs bound to the same site. For example, in hypoalbuminemia, binding may be reduced and high concentration of free drug may be attained because there is no albumin to bind to. For example, phenytoin and furosemide drugs will have this effect. What are the clinical importance of higher plasma protein bound drugs? So the drugs that are having plasma protein binding, they'll have usually like long duration of action. The distribution for such drug is low. The volume of distribution for such drug is low because they stay in the plasma and they do not get distributed. High plasma protein bound drug can be displaced by another highly bound drug. That is, when a drug is bound to a molecule, they can get displaced, but by a molecule that is having more bonding to the particular site. In case of dialysis, it is not effective for drugs having high plasma protein binding because dialysis does not filter proteins. So dialysis removes only those drugs which are present in sufficient free concentration in plasma. So dialysis is not effective in the drugs that are highly plasma protein bound. An easy way to remember this is avoid dialysis. This mnemonic A stands for amphetamines, V for verapamil, O for opioids, I for imipramine, D for digitalis, and dialysis for diazepam. Next sequence is metabolism. So liver is the primary site for this metabolism, and the most of the drugs are inactivated by metabolism. But some drugs may be activated, that is the drugs that are in the form of prodrug, they gets activated after the metabolism. Metabolism may occur with the help of microsomal or non-microsomal enzymes. The microsomal enzymes like monoxidase, cytochrome P450 or glucuronide transferase, they may be induced or inhibited by other drugs. Whereas non-microsomal enzymes, they are not subject to these interactions. So there are different kind of drugs that either induce or stop the enzymes. So the drugs that are enzyme inducers, they can be remembered as GPRS cell phone. G for glycofulvin, P for phenytoin, R for rifampicin, S for smoking, cell for carbazepamin, and phone for phenobarbitone. And the enzyme inhibitors are valproate, ketoconazole, cimetidine, ciprofloxacin, erythromycin, and isoniazid. So what is a prodrug? Few drugs are inactive as such and need conversion in the body to one or more active metabolites. Such drugs are called prodrug. The prodrug may offer advantages over active form in being more stable, having better bioavailability or other desirable pharmacokinetic properties, or less side effects and toxicity. Some prodrugs are activated selectively at the site of action. The examples of prodrug and active drug include levodopa to dopamine, proguanil to cycloguanil, fluorouracil to fluoroquinidine, acyclovir to acyclovir triphosphate, and others, as you can see on your screen. So metabolic reaction can be divided into two parts, phase 1 or non-synthetic and phase 2 or synthetic reactions. The phase 1 reaction, here the functional group get attached to the drug molecule and the drug become water soluble or lipid soluble. But in phase 2, a conjugate is attached to drug, making the molecule as water soluble. Example of phase 1 are oxidation, reduction, hydrolysis, cyclization and decyclization. Example of phase 2 are glucuronidation, acetylation, methylation, sulfation and glycine conjugation. As we can see in phase 1, the drug after phase 1 gets converted into metabolite, and to this metabolite in the phase 2 a conjugate is attached. This metabolite can be lipid soluble or water soluble, but after phase 2 this metabolite is definitely a water soluble molecule that can get easily excreted. Here also the drug can either go through directly under the phase 2 metabolism and ultimately gets excreted. Metabolic reaction, as we just now described, can be phase 1 and phase 2, and these are the different metabolic reactions that takes place. The last point in the pharmacokinetics is excretion. So as the liver was the major site for metabolism, the major site or major route for excretion is kidney. Excretion through kidney occur by glomerular filtration, tubular reabsorption and tubular secretion. First is filtration. Filtration depends on the plasma protein binding and renal blood flow. It does not depend on lipid solubility because all substances can cross the fenestrated glomerular membrane. Next is tubular reabsorption. Tubular reabsorption depends on the lipid solubility. So we just now saw GFR or glomerular filtration, it depends on the plasma protein binding and renal blood flow. Tubular reabsorption depends on lipid solubility, whereas GFR does not depend on the lipid solubility. If a drug is lipid soluble, more of it will be reabsorbed. So a lipid soluble or unionized form of drug is easily reabsorbed, whereas ionized form is easily excreted and lesser reabsorbed. Lipid solubility depends on ionization. The ionized drug will be excreted by the kidney, as just now I explained. So, for example, say when you are having poisoning by acidic drug like salicylate or barbiturate. So, you in this case, urine should be alkalinized, because in alkaline environment, an acidic drug will be converted more into the ionized form, that is water soluble form. And so we have to alkalinize the urine with the help of sodium bicarbonate, and in this case more of the ionized molecules will be formed and they'll be easily excreted. Same way, if there is poisoning with basic substance like morphine or amphetamine, we have to acidify the urine. So tubular secretion, that we just now discussed, that it does not depend on the lipid solubility or plasma protein binding. In the nephron, separate pumps are present for acidic and basic drugs. Drugs utilizing the same transporter may show drug interaction. That is, if two different drugs have to pass through the same pathway, they'll have some interactions. For example, probenecid decreases the excretion of penicillin because it competes with the penicillin, but it increases the excretion of uric acid. Now we have to remember that exogenous substance like penicillin are removed, whereas endogenous substance like uric acid are retained by this pump. So both of these actions are reversed by probenecid, as we just now discussed. We need to understand the kinetics of elimination. Rate of elimination is the amount of drug eliminated per unit time. It is seen as function of plasma concentration. We derive an important parameter known as clearance. So clearance is nothing but rate of elimination of drug divided by plasma concentration. This kinetics of excretion can be first order kinetics or zero order kinetics. In the first order kinetics excretion, constant fraction of drug is eliminated, whereas in zero order kinetics, constant amount of drug is eliminated per unit time. Just to understand, we can remember that in first order kinetics, constant fraction, that is constant percentage of drug, is eliminated. So if we say that in the beginning we had 100 units of drug, and fraction of drug being eliminated is 5%. So in the beginning, 5% of 100 will get excreted, that is 5. Then 5%, the remaining part will be 95. Then again 5% of 95 will get excreted. So a constant fraction of drug will keep on getting excreted, whereas in the zero order kinetics, a constant amount of drug is being excreted. So what happens over here is that 5 units of drugs has to be excreted. So out of 100, first 5 will get excreted, then remaining will be 95. Again here 5 will get excreted, then 90 will remain. Then again 5 will get excreted. So here constant amount of drug is being excreted as compared to constant fraction, as we saw in the first order kinetics. So rate of elimination in the zero order kinetics is independent of the plasma concentration, and as we just now saw, clearance will be low at concentration. The clearance will be more at low concentration and less at higher concentration. In our example, we saw that excretion that was 5 at 100, that will be less at higher concentration, but as we keep on going low and as the concentration will become low, the clearance will be considered high. That, for example, when in the same sequence, when only 20 units of drugs will be remaining, and again if 5 has to go, it will be considered higher clearance. In first order kinetics, the clearance and the half-life will remain constant, whereas in the zero order kinetics, half-life is less at lower concentration. So as we saw, when only 10 units of the drug will be remaining and again 5 has to go, the half-life will be reduced drastically as compared to the half-life that will be reduced when 5 units will go out of the 100 units. Most of the drugs will follow the first order kinetics, whereas very few drugs will follow pure zero order kinetics. Example is alcohol. Any drug at higher concentration may show zero order kinetics. Here, as the dose rate increases, there is a straight line, that is increase in the plasma concentration, because a constant amount of drug has to be excreted and a constant amount of drug is being added. So this line is staying straight. But in zero order kinetics, up to some level it is going straight, but then the concentration is suddenly increasing.
This is known as zero order kinetics because, as we just now saw, the clearance is low at higher concentration. So at the concentration will increase, the clearance will be less. So more amount of drug will stay in the body. So the average or the constant steady state plasma concentration will increase. The drug whose kinetics changes from first order to zero order at therapeutic concentration are said to follow zero order kinetics. An easy way to remember the drugs that are following zero order kinetics are 0 watt power. Z, like W is for warfarin, A for alcohol, T for theophylline, T for tolbutamine, and power for phenytoin. Plasma half-life or T1/2 is time taken for a drug's plasma concentration to be reduced to half of its original value. Here in this slope, we can see an initially declining phase. It is due to distribution of the drug, and a lesser decline beta slope that is due to elimination or excretion. So in this image, we can see at least two half-lives, the distribution half-life and elimination half-life. In general, this elimination half-life is simply called half-life of the drug. A drug's half-life determines how often it must be taken or how long it will take in order for this drug to be viewed out. So number of half-life, percentage elimination, and then a percentage of drug remaining. So what we can see is in the beginning, the percentage eliminated is 0 and 100% of the drug will be remaining. After, at the end of first half-life, only 50% of it will remain because 50% has got excreted. At the end of second half-life, only 25% will remain and 75% of that would have got excreted. At the end of third half-life, 12.5% will remain and 87.5% would have got excreted. Same way, it takes up to 6 half-lives in order to clear majority of the drug from the body. So this assumes normal liver and kidney function in order to follow this same criteria, and older, younger and sick person may clear drugs more slowly as compared to the normal individuals. Dosing strategy. The drugs having high volume of distribution are given by this strategy. So there are two doses, loading dose and maintenance dose. First, a large dose is administered to attain a steady state quickly. That is, like, we give a larger amount of dose at one time in the beginning so that we get a steady state. Then we have to give the maintenance dose based on the clearance. Whatever part of drug is being cleared off or excreted from the body, only that much part of the dose we are giving again. So that is known as maintenance dose. Loading dose, as I just now said, it is given for the tissue stores. So it is mainly dependent on the volume of distribution. Loading dose is equal to volume of distribution into target plasma concentration. Whereas maintenance dose is dependent on the clearance. Maintenance dose is equal to clearance into target plasma concentration. So these two are MCQs. That loading dose is dependent on, the answer will be volume of distribution. Whereas maintenance dose is dependent on, the answer will be clearance. Okay everyone, that's all from my side. All the best.